Yuri Gagarin. Yuri Alexeyevich Gagarin, March 9, 1934, March 27, 1968, was a Soviet Air Force's pilot and cosmonaut who became the first human to journey into outer space, achieving a major milestone in the space race. His capsule Vostok 1 completed one orbit of Earth on April 12, 1961. Gagarin became an international celebrity and was awarded many medals and titles, including Hero of the Soviet Union, his nation's highest honor. Born in the village of Klushino near a town later renamed after him, in his youth Gagarin was a foundry man at a steel plant in Lyubierza. He later joined the Soviet Air Forces as a pilot and was stationed at the Luostari Air Base, near the Norwegian border, before his selection for the Soviet space program with five other cosmonauts. Following his space flight, Gagarin became deputy training director of the Cosmonaut Training Center, which was later named after him. He was also elected as a deputy of the Soviet of the Union in 1962 and then to the Soviet of Nationalities, respectively the lower and upper chambers of the Supreme Soviet. Vostok 1 was Gagarin's only spaceflight, but he served as the backup crew to the Soyuz 1 mission, which ended in a fatal crash, killing his friend and fellow cosmonaut Vladimir Komarov. Fearing for his life, Soviet officials permanently banned Gagarin from further space flights, but he advocated to be allowed to fly regular aircraft, which he was permitted to do after completing his education at the Zhukovsky Air Force Engineering Academy on February 17, 1968. Gagarin died 5 weeks later when the MiG-15 training jet he was piloting with his flight instructor Vladimir Saryajin crashed near the town of Kerch. Early life. Yuri Gagarin was born March 9, 1934 in the village of Klushino, near Gzotsk, renamed Gagarin in 1968 after his death. His parents worked on a collective farm, Alexei Ivanovich Gagarin as a carpenter and Anna Timofeyevna Gagarina as a dairy farmer. Yuri was the third of four children. His siblings were brothers Valentin, 1924, and Boris, 1936, and sister Zoya, 1927. Like millions of Soviet Union citizens, the Gagarin family suffered during the Nazi occupation of Soviet Union during World War II. Klushino was occupied in November 1941 during the German advance on Moscow, and a German officer took over the Gagarin residence. The family were allowed to build a mud hut approximately 3 by 3 meters, 10 by 10 feet, inside on the land behind their house, where they spent 21 months until the end of the occupation. His two older siblings were deported by the Germans to Poland for slave labor in 1943 and did not return until after the war in 1945. In 1946, the family moved to Gzotsk, where Gagarin continued his secondary education. In 1950, aged 16, Gagarin began an apprenticeship as a foundry man at a steel plant in Lyubierza, near Moscow, and enrolled at a local young workers' school for 7th grade evening classes. After graduating in 1951 from both the 7th grade and the vocational school with honors in mold making and foundry work, he was selected for further training at the Saratov Industrial Technical School, where he studied tractors. While in Saratov, Gagarin volunteered at a local flying club for weekend training as a Soviet air cadet, where he trained to fly a biplane, and later a Yak-18. He earned extra money as a part-time dock laborer on the Volga River. Soviet Air Force Service. In 1955, Gagarin was accepted to the first Chkalovsky Higher Air Force Pilots School, a flight school in Orenburg. He initially began training on the Yak-18 already familiar to him and later graduated to training on the MiG-15 in February 1956. Gagarin twice struggled to land the two-seater trainer aircraft, and risked dismissal from pilot training. However, the commander of the regiment decided to give him another chance at landing. Gagarin's flight instructor gave him a cushion to sit on, which improved his view from the cockpit, and he landed successfully. Having completed his evaluation in a trainer aircraft, Gagarin began flying solo in 1957. On November 5, 1957, Gagarin was commissioned a lieutenant in the Soviet Air Forces, having accumulated 166 hours and 47 minutes of flight time. He graduated from flight school the next day and was posted to the Luostari Air Base close to the Norwegian border in Murmansk Oblast for a two-year assignment with the Northern Fleet. On July 7, 1959, he was rated military pilot third class. After expressing interest in space exploration following the launch of Luna 3 on October 6, 1959, his recommendation to the Soviet space program was endorsed and forwarded by Lieutenant Colonel Babushkin. By this point, he had accumulated 265 hours of flight time. Gagarin was promoted to the rank of senior lieutenant on November 6, 1959, 3 weeks after he was interviewed by a medical commission for qualification to the space program. Soviet space program. Selection and training. Gagarin's selection for the Vostok program was overseen by the Central Flight Medical Commission led by Major General Konstantin Fyodorovich Borodin of the Soviet Army Medical Service. He underwent physical and psychological testing conducted at Central Aviation Scientific Research Hospital, in Moscow, commanded by Colonel A.S. Yuzhnov, a member of the commission. The commission also included Colonel Yevgeny Anatolievich Karpov, who later commanded the training center, Colonel Vladimir Ivanovich Yazdovsky, the head physician for Gagarin's flight, and Major General Alexander Nikolaevich Babishuk, a physician flag officer on the Soviet Air Force General Staff to the Commander-in-Chief of the Air Force. The commission limited their selection to pilots between 25 and 30 years old. The chief engineer of the program, Sergei Korolev, also specified that candidates, to fit in the limited space in the Vostok capsule, should weigh less than 72 kilograms, 159 pounds, and be no taller than 1.70 meters, 5 feet 7 in, height. Gagarin was 1.57 meters, 5 feet 2 in, tall. From a pool of 154 qualified pilots shortlisted by their Air Force units, the military physicians chose 29 cosmonaut candidates, of which 20 were approved by the Credential Committee of the Soviet government. The first 12, including Gagarin, were approved on March 7, 1960, and 8 more were added in a series of subsequent orders issued until June. Gagarin began training at the Hodinka airfield in downtown Moscow on March 15, 1960. The training regiment involved vigorous and repetitive physical exercises which Alexei Leonov, a member of the initial group of 12, described as akin to training for the Olympics Games. In April 1960, they began parachute training in Saratov Oblast and each completed about 40 to 50 jumps from both low and high altitude, over both land and water. Gagarin was a candidate favored by his peers. When they were asked to vote anonymously for a candidate besides themselves they would like to be the first to fly, all but three chose Gagarin. One of these candidates, Yevgeny Krenov, believed that Gagarin was very focused and was demanding of himself and others when necessary. On May 30, 1960, Gagarin was further selected for an accelerated training group, known as the Vanguard 6 or Sochi 6, from which the first cosmonauts of the Vostok program would be chosen. The other members of the group were Anatoly Kardashov, Andrian Nikolaev, Pavel Popovich, German Titov, and Valentin Varlamov. However, Kardashov and Varlamov were injured and replaced by Krenov and Grigory Nelyubov. As several of the candidates selected for the program, including Gagarin, did not have higher education degrees, they were enrolled into a correspondence course program at the Zhukovsky Air Force Engineering Academy. Gagarin enrolled in the program in September 1960 and did not earn his specialist diploma until early 1968. Gagarin was also subjected to experiments that were designed to test physical and psychological endurance, including oxygen starvation tests in which the cosmonauts were locked in an isolation chamber and the air slowly pumped out. He also trained for the upcoming flight by experiencing G-forces in a centrifuge. Psychological tests included placing the candidates in an anechoic chamber in complete isolation. Gagarin was in the chamber on 26 July to 5 August. In August 1960, a Soviet Air Force doctor evaluated his personality as follows. The Vanguard 6 were given the title of pilot cosmonaut in January 1961 and entered a two-day examination conducted by a special interdepartmental commission led Lieutenant General Nikolai Kamenin, the overseer of the Vostok program. The commission was tasked with ranking of the candidates based on their mission readiness for the first human Vostok mission. On 17 January, they were tested in a simulator at the M.M. Gromov Flight Research Institute on a full-size mock-up of the Vostok capsule. Gagarin, Nikolaev, Popovich, and Titov all received excellent marks on the first day of testing, in which they were required to describe the various phases of the mission followed by questions from commission. On the second day, they were given a written examination following which the special commission ranked Gagarin as the best candidate for the first mission. He and the next two highest-ranked cosmonauts, Titov and Nelyubov, were sent to Tyuratom for final preparations. Gagarin and Titov were selected to train in the flight-ready spacecraft on 7 April. Historian Asif Siddiqui writes of the final selection. Vostok 1. On April 12, 1961, at 6:07 a.m. UTC, the Vostok 3 Ka-3, Vostok 1, spacecraft was launched from Baikonur Cosmodrome. Data aboard was Gagarin, the first human to travel into space, using the call sign Keter, Russian, Siberian pine or cedar. The radio communication between the launch control room and Gagarin included the following dialogue at the moment of rocket launch. Gagarin's farewell to Korolev using the informal phrase Poikali later became a popular expression in the Eastern Bloc that was used to refer to the beginning of the space age. The five first stage engines fired until the first separation event, when the four side boosters fell away, leaving the core engine. The core stage then separated while the rocket was in a suborbital trajectory, and the upper stage carried it to orbit. Once the upper stage finished firing, it separated from the spacecraft, which orbited for 108 minutes before returning to Earth in Kazakhstan. Gagarin became the first human to orbit the Earth. The feeling of weightlessness was somewhat unfamiliar compared with Earth conditions. Here, you feel as if you were hanging in a horizontal position in straps. You feel as if you were suspended, Gagarin wrote in his post-flight report. He also wrote in his autobiography released the same year that he sang the tune The Motherland Hears, The Motherland Knows, during re-entry. Gagarin was recognized as a qualified military pilot first class and promoted to the rank of major in a special order given during his flight. At about 7,000 meters, 23,000 feet, Gagarin ejected from the descending capsule as planned and landed using a parachute. There were concerns Gagarin's spaceflight record would not be certified by the Fédération Aéronautique Internationale, FAI, the world governing body for setting standards and keeping records in the field, which at the time required that the pilot land with the craft. Gagarin and Soviet officials initially refused to admit that he had not landed with his spacecraft, an admission which became apparent after Titov's subsequent flight on Vostok 2 4 months later. Gagarin's spaceflight records were nonetheless certified and again reaffirmed by the FAI, which revised its rules, and acknowledged that the crucial steps of the safe launch, orbit, and return of the pilot had been accomplished. Gagarin continues to be internationally recognized as the first human in space and first to orbit the Earth. After the Vostok 1 flight, Gagarin's flight was a triumph for the Soviet space program and he became a national hero of the Soviet Union and Eastern Bloc, as well as a worldwide celebrity. Newspapers around the globe published his biography and details of his flight. He was escorted in a long motorcade of high-ranking officials through the streets of Moscow to the Kremlin where, in a lavish ceremony, Nikita Khrushchev awarded him the title Hero of the Soviet Union. Other cities in the Soviet Union also held mass demonstrations, the scale of which were second only to the World War II victory parades. Gagarin gained a reputation as an adept public figure and was noted for his charismatic smile. On April 15, 1961, accompanied by officials from the Soviet Academy of Sciences, he answered questions at a press conference in Moscow reportedly attended by 1,000 reporters. Gagarin visited the United Kingdom 3 months after the Vostok 1 mission, going to London and Manchester. While in Manchester, despite heavy rain, he refused an umbrella, insisted that the roof of the convertible car he was riding in remain open, and stood so the cheering crowds could see him. Gagarin toured widely abroad, accepting the invitation of about 30 countries in the years following his flight. In just the first 4 months, he also went to Brazil, Bulgaria, Canada, Cuba, Czechoslovakia, Finland, Hungary, and Iceland. Because of his instant rise to fame, U.S. President John F. Kennedy barred Gagarin from visiting the United States. In 1962, Gagarin began serving as a deputy to the Soviet of the Union, and was elected to the Central Committee of the Young Communist League. He later returned to Star City, the cosmonaut facility, where he spent several years working on designs for a reusable spacecraft. He became a lieutenant colonel of the Soviet Air Forces on June 12, 1962, and received the rank of colonel on November 6, 1963. On 20th of December, Gagarin became deputy training director of the cosmonaut training facility. Soviet officials, including Kamenin, tried to keep Gagarin away from any flights, being worried about losing their hero in an accident, noting that he was too dear to mankind to risk his life for the sake of an ordinary space flight. Kamenin was also concerned by Gagarin's drinking and believed the sudden rise to fame had taken its toll on the cosmonaut. While acquaintances say Gagarin had been a sensible drinker, his touring schedule placed him in social situations in which he was increasingly expected to drink alcohol. 2 years later, he was re-elected as a deputy of the Soviet Union, but this time to the Soviet of Nationalities, the upper chamber of legislature. The following year, he began to re-qualify as a fighter pilot and was backup pilot for his friend Vladimir Komarov on the Soyuz 1 flight after 5 years without piloting duty. Kamenin had opposed Gagarin's reassignment to cosmonaut training. He had gained weight and his flying skills had deteriorated. Despite this, he remained the strong contender for Soyuz 1 until he was replaced by Komarov in April 1966 and reassigned to Soyuz 3. The Soyuz 1 launch was rushed due to implicit political pressures and despite Gagarin's protests that additional safety precautions were necessary. Gagarin accompanied Komarov to the rocket before launch and relayed instructions to Komarov from ground control following multiple system failures aboard the spacecraft. Despite their best efforts, Soyuz 1 crash-landed after its parachutes failed to open, killing Komarov instantly. After the Soyuz 1 crash, Gagarin was permanently banned from training for and participating in further spaceflights. He was also grounded from flying aircraft solo, a demotion he worked hard to lift. He was temporarily relieved of duties to focus on academics with the promise that he would be able to resume flight training. On February 17, 1968, Gagarin successfully defended his aerospace engineering thesis on the subject of spaceplane aerodynamic configuration and graduated cum laude from the Zhukovsky Air Force Engineering Academy. Personal life. Gagarin was a keen sportsman and played ice hockey as a goalkeeper. He was also a basketball fan and coached the Saratov Industrial Technical School team, as well as being a referee. In 1957, while a cadet in flight school, Gagarin met Valentina Goryacheva at the May Day celebrations at the Red Square in Moscow. She was a medical technician who had graduated from Orenburg Medical School. They were married on 7th of November of the same year, the same day Gagarin graduated from his flight school, and they had two daughters. Yelena Yuryevna Gagarina, born 1959, is an art historian who has worked as the Director General of the Moscow Kremlin Museum since 2001, and Galina Yuryevna Gagarina, born 1961, is a professor of economics in the department chair at Plohanov Russian University of Economics in Moscow. Following his rise to fame, at a Black Sea resort in September 1961, he was reportedly caught by his wife during a liaison with a nurse who had aided him after a boating incident. He attempted to escape through a window and jumped off a second-floor balcony. The resulting injury left a permanent scar above his left eyebrow. Some sources have said that Gagarin commented during his flight, "I don't see any God up here," though no such words appear in the verbatim record of his conversations with Earth stations during the spaceflight. In a 2006 interview, Gagarin's friend Colonel Valentin Petrov stated that Gagarin never said these words and that the quote originated from Nikita Khrushchev's speech at the plenum of the Central Committee of the CPSU about the state's anti-religion campaign, saying Gagarin flew into space, but didn't see any God there. Petrov also said Gagarin had been baptized into the Orthodox Church as a child, and a 2011 FOMA magazine article quoted the rector of the Orthodox Church in Star City saying, "Gagarin baptized his elder daughter Yelena shortly before his space flight, and his family used to celebrate Christmas and Easter and keep icons in the house." Death. On March 27, 1968, while on a routine training flight from Chkalovsky Air Base, Gagarin and flight instructor Vladimir Saryajin died when their MiG-15 Yutai crashed near the town of Kerch. The bodies of Gagarin and Saryajin were cremated and their ashes interred in the walls of the Kremlin. Wrapped in secrecy, the cause of the crash that killed Gagarin is uncertain and became the subject of several theories. At least three investigations into the crash were conducted separately by the Air Force, official government commissions, and the KGB. According to a biography of Gagarin by Jamie Duran and Piers Pezzoni, Starman, The Truth Behind the Legend of Yuri Gagarin, the KGB worked not just alongside the Air Force and the official commission members but against them. The KGB's report, declassified in March 2003, dismissed various conspiracy theories and instead indicated the actions of airbase personnel contributed to the crash. The report states that an air traffic controller provided Gagarin with outdated weather information and that by the time of his flight, conditions had deteriorated significantly. Ground crew also left external fuel tanks attached to the aircraft. Gagarin's planned flight activities needed clear weather and no outboard tanks. The investigation concluded Gagarin's aircraft entered a spin, either due to a bird strike or because of a sudden move to avoid another aircraft. Because of the out-of-date weather report, the crew believed their altitude was higher than it was and could not react properly to bring the MiG-15 out of its spin. Another theory, advanced in 2005 by the original crash investigator, hypothesizes that a cabin air vent was accidentally left open by the crew or the previous pilot, leading to oxygen deprivation and leaving the crew incapable of controlling the aircraft. A similar theory, published in Air and Space magazine, is that the crew detected the open vent and followed procedure by executing a rapid dive to a lower altitude. This dive caused them to lose consciousness and crash. On April 12, 2007, the Kremlin vetoed a new investigation into the death of Gagarin. Government officials said they saw no reason to begin a new investigation. In April 2011, documents from a 1968 commission set up by the Central Committee of the Communist Party to investigate the accident were declassified. The documents revealed that the commission's original conclusion was that Gagarin or Zaryagin had maneuvered sharply, either to avoid a weather balloon or to avoid entry into the upper limit of the first layer of cloud cover, leading the jet into a supercritical flight regime and to its stalling in complex meteorological conditions. Leonov, who was also a member of a state commission established to investigate Gagarin's death, was conducting parachute training sessions that day and heard two loud booms in the distance. He believes that a Sukhoi Su-15 was flying below its minimum altitude and, without realizing it because of the terrible weather conditions, he passed within 10 or 20 meters of Yuri and Zaryagin's plane while breaking the sound barrier. The resulting turbulence would have sent the MiG-15 Yutai into an uncontrolled spin. Leonov said the first boom he heard was that of the jet breaking the sound barrier and the second was Gagarin's plane crashing. In a June 2013 interview with Russian television network RT, Leonov said a report on the incident confirmed the presence of a second aircraft, an unauthorized Su-15, flying in the area. However, as a condition of being allowed to discuss the declassified report, Leonov was barred from disclosing the name of the Su-15 pilot who was 80 years old and in poor health as of 2013. Awards and honors. Medals and orders of merit. On April 14, 1961, Gagarin was honored with a 12-mile, 19 kilometers, parade attended by millions of people that concluded at the Red Square. After a short speech, he was bestowed the Hero of the Soviet Union, Order of Lenin, Merited Master of Sports of the Soviet Union and the first pilot cosmonaut of the USSR. On 15 April, the Soviet Academy of Sciences awarded him with the Konstantin Tsiolkovsky Gold Medal, named after the Russian pioneer of space aeronautics. Gagarin had also been awarded four Soviet commemorative medals over the course of his career. He was honored as a Hero of Socialist Labor, Czechoslovakia, on April 29, 1961, and Hero of Socialist Labor, Bulgaria, including the Order of Georgi Dimitrov, the same year. On the 8th anniversary of the beginning of the Cuban Revolution, 26th of July, President Osvaldo Dordicoz of Cuba presented him with the first commander of the Order of Playa Heron, a newly created medal. Gagarin was also awarded the 1960 Gold Air Medal and the 1961 De La Valks Medal from the Fédération Aéronautique Internationale in Switzerland. He received numerous awards from other nations that year, including the Star of the Republic of Indonesia, Second Class, the Order of the Cross of Grunwald, First Degree, in Poland, the Order of the Flag of the Republic of Hungary, the Hero of Labor Award from Democratic Republic of Vietnam, the Italian Columbus Day Medal, and a gold medal from the British Interplanetary Society. President Jeanine Quadros of Brazil decorated Gagarin on August 2, 1961 with the Order of Aeronautical Merit, Commander Grade. During a tour of Egypt in late January 1962, Gagarin received the Order of the Nile and the Golden Keys to the Gates of Cairo. On October 22, 1963, Gagarin and Valentina Tereshkova were honored with the Order of Karl Marx from the German Democratic Republic. Tributes. The date of Gagarin's space flight, 12th of April, has been commemorated. Since 1962, it has been celebrated in the USSR and most of its former territories as Cosmonautics Day. Since 2000, Yuri's Night, an international celebration, is held annually to commemorate milestones in space exploration. In 2011, it was declared the International Day of Human Space Flight by the United Nations. A number of buildings and locations have been named for Gagarin. The Yuri Gagarin Cosmonaut Training Center in Star City was named on April 30, 1968. The launch pad at Baikonur Cosmodrome from which Sputnik 1 and Vostok 1 were launched is now known as Gagarin's Start. Gagarin Rayon in Sevastopol, Ukraine, was named after him during the period of the Soviet Union. The Russian Air Force Academy was renamed the Gagarin Air Force Academy in 1968. A street in Warsaw, Poland, is called Yuri Gagarin Street. The town of Gagarin, Armenia was renamed in his honor in 1961. Gagarin has been honored on the moon by astronauts and astronomers. During the American space program's Apollo 11 mission in 1969, astronauts Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin left a memorial satchel containing medals commemorating Gagarin and Komarov on the moon's surface. In 1971, Apollo 15 astronauts David Scott and James Irwin left the small fallen astronaut sculpture at their landing site as a memorial to the American astronauts and Soviet cosmonauts who died in the space race. The names on its plaque included Yuri Gagarin and 14 others. In 1970, a 262 kilometers, 163 miles, wide crater on the far side after him. Gagarin was inducted as a member of the 1976 inaugural class of the International Space Hall of Fame in New Mexico. Gagarin is memorialized in music, a cycle of Soviet patriotic songs titled The Constellation Gagarin, Sozvezdy Gagarina, was written by Alexander Pakhomutov and Nikolai Dobronravov in 1970-1971. The most famous of these songs refers to Gagarin's Poikali. In the lyrics, he said let's go. He waved his hand. He was the inspiration for the pieces Hey Gagarin by Jean-Michel Jarre on Metamorphose, Gagarin by Public Service Broadcasting, and Gagarin, I Love You by Undervud. Vessels have been named for Gagarin. Soviet tracking ship Cosmonavt Yuri Gagarin was built in 1971 and the Armenian airline Armavia named their first Sukhoi Superjet 100 in his honor in 2011. Two commemorative coins were issued in the Soviet Union to honor the 20th and 30th anniversaries of his flight, a 1-ruble coin in copper-nickel, 1981, and a 3-ruble coin in silver, 1991. In 2001, to commemorate the 40th anniversary of Gagarin's flight, a series of 4 coins bearing his likeness was issued in Russia. It consisted of a 2-ruble coin in copper-nickel, a 3-ruble coin in silver, a 10-ruble coin in brass copper and nickel, and a 100-ruble coin in silver. In 2011, Russia issued a 1,000-ruble coin in gold and a 3-ruble coin in silver to mark the 50th anniversary of his flight. In 2008, the Continental Hockey League named their championship trophy the Gagarin Cup. In a 2010 Space Foundation survey, Gagarin was ranked as the 6th most popular space hero, tied with Star Trek's fictional James T. Kirk. A Russian docudrama titled Gagarin, First in Space was released in 2013. Previous attempts at portraying Gagarin were disallowed. His family took legal action over his portrayal in a fictional drama and vetoed a musical. Statues, monuments and murals. There are statues of Gagarin and monuments to him located in the town named after him as well as in Orenburg, Cheboksary, Irkutsk, Izhevsk, Komsomolsk-on-Amur, and Yashkar-Ola in Russia, as well as in Nicosia, Cyprus, Druzhkivka, Ukraine, Karganda, Kazakhstan, and Tiraspol, Moldova. On June 4, 1980, monument to Yuri Gagarin in Gagarin Square, Leninsky Avenue, Moscow, was opened. The monument is mounted to a 38 meters, 125 feet, tall pedestal and is constructed of titanium. Beside the column is a replica of the descent module used during his space flight. In 2011, a statue of Gagarin was unveiled at Admiralty Arch in the Mall in London, opposite the permanent sculpture of James Cook. It is a copy of the statue outside Gagarin's former school in Lyubierza. In 2013, the statue was moved to a permanent location outside the Royal Observatory, Greenwich. In 2012, a statue was unveiled at the site of NASA's original spaceflight headquarters on South Wayside Drive in Houston. The sculpture was completed in 2011 by Leonov, who is also an artist, and was a gift to Houston by various Russian organizations. Houston Mayor Anise Parker, NASA Administrator Charles Bolden, and Russian Ambassador Sergei Kislyak were present for the dedication. The Russian Federation presented a bust of Gagarin to several cities in India, including one that was unveiled at the Birla Planetarium in Kolkata in February 2012. In April 2018, a bust of Gagarin erected on the street in Belgrade, Serbia, that bears his name was removed, after less than a week. A new work was commissioned following the outcry over the disproportionately small size of its head, which locals said was an insult to Gagarin. Belgrade city manager Joran Vesic stated that neither the city, the Serbian Ministry of Culture, nor the foundation that financed it had prior knowledge of the design. In August 2019, the Italian artist Jurit painted Gagarin's face on the facade of a 20-story building in the district of Udintsova, Russia. The mural is the largest portrait of Gagarin in the world. 50th anniversary. The 50th anniversary of Gagarin's journey into space was marked in 2011 by tributes around the world. A film titled First Orbit was shot from the International Space Station, combining sound recordings from the original flight with footage of the route taken by Gagarin. The Russian, American, and Italian crew of Expedition 27 aboard the ISS sent a special video message to wish the people of the world a happy Yuri's night, wearing shirts with an image of Gagarin. The Central Bank of the Russian Federation released gold and silver coins to commemorate the anniversary. The Soyuz TMA-21 spacecraft was named Gagarin with the launch in April 2011 to coincide with the 50th anniversary of his mission. Notes: 50th anniversary of his mission. Notes: 50th anniversary of his mission. Notes: 50th anniversary of his mission. Notes.